park, niggas know me. Curb on, little homie. All days, yeah. Been a road, been a road.
And with you being around that long and having that king ability to estimate bullshit or overhypeness or underhypeness, like when you run into a situation when you say that this guy really just he freestyled, he just fabricating all this stuff. When do the part of the interview you say, well, I'm gonna keep pressing it because the shit sound interesting for my viewers, or you might say, I'm gonna back out of it and go another direction. You just play it by ear. How you do that?
I mean, it depends on the person, the situation, and so forth. At the end of the day, a person doesn't have a gun to their head when they answer these questions.
Right, yeah, right? I agree.
They call them interrogations, but it's not an interrogation. Mm. You walk out at any point, right? And you don't have to answer a question.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Sometimes you could even say, hey, you know, before the interview, you know, with Math Hoffa, he told me a couple of things he doesn't want to talk about in the interview.
Mm-hmm.
Beforehand, mm-hmm. And I respected that. Right. And then when I did it, you know, because I did an interview with him maybe a couple months before, and I told him the same thing.
Right.
So usually people respect each other when it comes to that type of thing.
Mm-hmm.
But when it comes to a person answering a question and they may not be 100 with it, I mean, number one, you have your facts ahead mm-hmm. of time. So a lot of times when I ask a question, I know the answer ahead of time,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
So I have that already. In my pocket. Mm-hmm. So if the answer comes out totally different mm-hmm. than what I found, it's like, well, you know, based on X, Y, and Z.
Yeah, that's my question.
That
you still poke at it?
This.
Okay.
You know, like I want to interview Keefe D. He wrote a book about the whole Tupac shooting incident. Mm-hmm. And then when we started doing the interview, he didn't want to answer certain questions or slide around him. But I'm like, well, in the book you said, and I would start quoting from the book.
Mm-hmm.
So at that point, what can you really say?
Mm-hmm.
You can either say, well, I didn't say that.
Mm-hmm.
Or someone else wrote it, but if it's your book and it's got your name on it, then you got to stand behind it.
Right.
And a lot of times, really, just comes down to the research of it all. Like, you do, you know, I have, you know, like my assistant will come up with the bulk of the research, but then I'll go in and start looking at other interviews. I'll start going back to what I remember, you know, because I'm 49 years old. I've been in the hip hop shit since there was hip hop, so I have an encyclopedic history of the genre already.
Mm-hmm.
That I could pull from.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, sometimes it's even talking to people who might know that person ahead
mm-hmm.
of time. Like, you know, like I'm friends with John Sally, who's a regular on my show. So sometimes we'll interview people that he's played with. He's mm-hmm. been on the same team as him mm-hmm. or so forth. So I might be able to call him and say, hey, tell me about this situation or mm-hmm. bring up some things that maybe other people might not know about.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
the other day you come in prepared.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're prepared, you could create a good story out of it.
Right, okay, yeah. So you kind of like, you ain't freestyle, you doing your leg work, you ain't just running up in there.
Right.
But it'd be sometime, like I've seen the show, I forgot the show, what it was, Queen Flip. I seen it, mm-hmm. FBI agent was on there.
Okay.
And I'm hearing this guy, now this is the FBI agent, this supposed to be the top of, we got all information.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm hearing him quoting stuff that was blatantly was wrong, far as some DC activities. So I'm like, damn, when do a dude even know he got accurate information? You know what I'm saying? Because I'm looking at this and I'm like, is this for real? So it's like, that's why I was just curious to know that, you know, that perspective on that, man. But let me change gears a little bit. Have you ever had any runs or stunt with any hard drug use or just any, you know?
Me?
Yeah, you, yourself.
Have I used hard drugs?
Yeah. And I ain't did no research to know that.
No, I'm just asking. I'll ask the question. I mean, I've tried ecstasy.
Okay. A
couple of times.
Right.
Wasn't really my thing.
Okay.
You know, I've tried acid once.
Mm.
I've tried mushrooms. I mean, through college and a few years afterwards, I was, you know, I tried mushrooms, you know, maybe about a dozen times. But that's pretty much where it stops. I mean, I'm a weed smoker. I smoke weed every day. It's not really hard drugs, but it is drugs. I never tried cocaine. You know, one of my close friends overdosed and died off cocaine at 23. So going to that funeral made me say, this is not something I want to mess with.
Right.
I've never tried heroin. I've never tried meth.
Right. And every time I see any movie and they show a scene, somebody taking ecstasy, they always make it be acting real sexual. Or is that a feeling you get that it make you a sexual drug like that? Or that's just Hollywood?
Nah, I remember my ex, we both took ecstasy and tried to have sex and both of us were like, ah. You know, but maybe that was the old ecstasy. Maybe the new Molly is something different. But I'm not really a hard drug user like that. And, you know, at 49, it's not something that I'm going to try to start, you know, at this point in my life. I've gone this far, you know, without smoking crack and, you know, doing cocaine and stuff like that.
Right, okay, okay. Yeah, and I read somewhere, or I might have heard you get an interview, they said you had a real close relationship with the BMF guys, Big Meech and them.
Not a close relationship. They flew me out. Like, during my mixtape days, you know, I had a really big mixtape. It was the Tupac Rap Phenomenon mixtape that won all the Mixtape of the Year awards and everything. So I think it was Blue Da Vinci from BMF was a fan of the mixtapes. Mm-hmm. And at the time, BMF was trying to push him as an artist. Mm-hmm. This was right when, right after Big Meech was involved in the shooting that ended up where Wolf got killed.
Okay.
Right? Where, I mean, he got shot himself. Right. He was on house arrest at the time. So they just flew me out, gave me a couple $1,000 and just partied with me to try to, like, essentially promote their artists. Mm-hmm. You know, but at that time, that's where I got to meet those guys. I got to meet Big Meech. You know, I was actually brought over to his house. Like, his mom was there, and she was cooking for everybody, and I got to hang out with them and party with them and so forth. But I wouldn't say I was close to any of those guys.
Oh, okay.
You know, maybe Blue a little bit. You know what I mean? I've interviewed him afterwards. But it was one of those situations where after, like, a day of hanging out with these guys and seeing the BMF, you know, seeing the BMF billboards, and seeing all the Lamborghinis, and the jewels, and the money, it was like it was obvious where this money was coming from.
Right.
Being a square, middle class kid, it was clear that this was not music money. Mm-hmm. Like, even the Jay-Z's in the world weren't balling like that.
Right.
You know, they
were
selling millions of albums.
Right.
So it was like, at that point, just a conscious decision that, like, hey man, this was fun, and I'm just going to back up out of this situation, go back to my boring, broke-ass life at the time, and not be involved with what's about to come next.
Right.
And we all saw what came next.
Right. And that's two times in your story when you were saying you're going to be the producer, then the situation with you know, the BMF guys let you was able to walk away, and they always train you. They said, no, never be so attached to something you can't walk away from it.
Yeah.
In 5 to 8 seconds, like, that's a strong, so you think that comes from your mother, your father, or you just think that's, I mean, what that instinct you think come from? Because that's a rare instinct, believe it or not.
I think it just comes from long-term thinking. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like I don't live for the moment. I'm thinking 10, 20, 30 years from now, and
that's my son. Pick that up, my son. Yeah. Make sure you hear that long term thinking. Like,
and that's really, as I got older and as I started to really understand how money works, I started to learn that the people with the most money have the longest timeline in terms of their planning, right? So, for example, you know, somebody who's homeless is just trying to get through the day.
Right.
Right. They're trying to make it to nighttime without you know, getting arrested or killed or, you know, have some food in their stomach. You know, someone who's making minimum wage is trying to make it to the end of the week. Someone who is, you know, middle class are thinking how they're going to get to the end of the year and what vacation they might take and how they're going to make their mortgage and stuff like that. But when you start getting into the really wealthy individuals out there, a lot of times they're thinking past their lifetime. You know what I'm saying? Like, you look at, like, a Muhammad Ali, who had a photographer around him everywhere he went. He understood the significance of who he was and how he's going to be perceived after he's gone, and he realized that he needs to document that while he's here. And this was a young man in his 20s that was already realizing that, but he already knew the trajectory that he was on. So I always had that sort of thinking in me of, like, okay, look, like, this, I plan on living for a long time. I don't plan on going to prison. I plan on having a successful career. I plan on being rich. I plan on, you know, being successful. That's only going to be accomplished if I'm thinking 5-10 years ahead. And if there's a situation that's going to potentially mess up me being around in those years, then that's something I don't need to be dealing with.
And I always heard that term, generational wealth, since I was young, but it was like, you made me think about, I was in a meeting with a guy, older Jewish guy in D.C., owned clubs, so one of my partners was trying to buy a person to build it from him, and the deal they were structuring was like a 10-year plan. The guy, 82, 83 now, and after we get it, he just was drinking, let's celebrate, and then he was partying. you know, just celebrate. And one of the guys with me was like saying, damn, like, one of the guys would say, damn, man, he ain't even going to be able to see that money. But his brain was so far out, like, mm-hmm. passing that money down to the family there, you know. Right. And that was one of my first words from seeing generation, seeing the process, you know what I'm saying? So that's deep thinking. What motivates Vlad, man? Who motivates Vlad and what motivates Vlad to do what he do and to keep shooting? What's your motivation? Or who motivates you?
I wouldn't say so much as a who anymore. Because I think that... I think that a lot of the media outlets that I looked up to when I was younger, and just a fan like Source and Double XL, mm-hmm. I've managed to surpass over time, mm-hmm. Which is not just because of me, but also because they weren't able to adapt to the market as well. It was a two prong kind of thing. Right. So it's not so much of a who. You know, I feel like when I look at the other interviewers out there, like the Oprahs or the Barbara Walters or the 60 Minutes and so forth, I feel like what I do is as good or better than whoever they are. Mm-hmm. I think these days really what motivates me is getting those interviews I've been always wanting to get for a long time and really being able to sit down with the people who I really admire and telling, really getting the type of stories that I want to get. Mm-hmm. Whether it's like a Sammy the Bull interview that I've been, you know, took me 2 years to actually lock that in and make the deal to make that happen, or I interviewed Tony Yayo recently. That was like a really interesting insight to the whole G-Unit story. Or, you know, the surviving member of Milli Vanilli to tell that whole story about how they had to give their Grammys back because they were all lip-syncing the whole time and so forth. Or the Keefe D story where he essentially told how Tupac got killed,
right.
And it's a sort of a definitive, like, I know that, like, after we're gone, people are still gonna be listening to Tupac.
Right.
And if they ever wanna know what happened to Tupac, there's only one place they could really go to.
Right.
And that's the Vlad TV.
All the information you did cover.
Right, telling the first hand, because he's the only surviving member in the car that did the shooting. Mm-hmm. Right, everyone else, the other three people in that car are dead.
Right.
They've never told the story. Yeah. So it's that type of shit where it's like, yo, this is like historical, and I know that when I put this together, years from now, people are gonna keep watching it, and it's gonna be used in schools, and people are gonna be writing their master's thesis on it, and so forth. Like that to me is the thrill.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you mentioned one of the media outlets, Source, me and Dave Mays, real close friends, and he have a phenomenal story, even not just his rise, but his fall or dip, you know, from what's name. And he actually was trying to make the transition to the new wave.
Yeah.
And just, you know.
Yeah, I mean, we did an interview. I didn't do the interview myself, but we interviewed Dave about that, as well as Benzino.
Right. Okay, you interviewed both of them. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, that was name.
Yeah, that's an example of a company that was on top, like the biggest entity in hip-hop, period. Like they would call it the hip-hop Bible, right? To call it that and no one really questioned it was a big deal, and they had total dominance of the space. But then things shifted. The internet came, and they weren't able to properly transition to the next wave. They could be way bigger than Vlad TV right now. They should be there, but if you look at what happened with Dave, he took on all these millions of dollars in loans, which he tried to build this website, which ultimately ended up going nowhere. But you know, but that's that wasn't really how, you know, whether it was not the right direction or he didn't have the right people to show him the right way to do it. Because first, you know, Worldstar came in and did it.
Right.
You know, whether it's the right way or the wrong way, they did it to the fact where it was successful. Even to this day, there's a worldstarhiphop.com.
Right.
So it's that type of thing. That's why you always have to stay ahead and really look for what the next big thing in the business is and how things are changing, because you can end up being a dinosaur in a couple of years if you don't watch out.
And a lot of times, being the first sometimes can be a problem. It's like it's like somebody running the door. The first person to kick the door usually gets shot. You know what I'm saying? So sometimes that be how it happened. The third man get all he got the press conference and get the award, right?
So, yeah, I mean, I always like to say, like, if you look at Google, they were not the first search engine. Mm-hmm. There was like a bunch of, like before them, it was like Alta Vista and Magellan and all these other search engines that you never even heard of anymore because they're all gone. But Google came in years later and they just were the best and they rose to dominance. Mm-hmm. That's why I've never really looked at competition as being first. Mm-hmm. It's like I moved to New York as a mixtape DJ, and that's when there was a million mixtape DJs. Everyone was a mixtape DJ, and still I was able to come in and win the biggest award of that year, being someone that came in very late in the game. Even I was like in my late 20s. I was like 29 at the time, or 30.
So was DJ Clue still doing it?
DJ Clue was, yeah, one of the big DJs.
So you beat him out of one of the years?
Well, for that year, yeah. Mm-hmm. We had the biggest mixtape that year. I mean, Clue, K-Slay, Drama, all those guys, yeah. But it was like, yo, if you come in, it doesn't matter if you're first or not, if you come in with the best product, that's going to rise to the top. Exactly. That's always been my mentality.
It's like the streets, good dope sell itself,
that's
man.
That's right.
Exactly. Sell itself. What's the name? I know people got a lot of opinions about it, so I'm pretty sure you got a lot of threats over the years. Mm-hmm. Any threat you got that actually made you uncomfortable, you was like, man, I got to be a little more, take this one a little more serious than the other ones.
Take them all serious.
Take them all serious?
Oh. Armed security right now.
Oh, yeah, yeah,
right.
Yeah.
You know, some shit pop off right now. We're prepared for it.
Right.
But, you know, at the end of the day, I also don't hang out the way I used to. Mm-hmm. So it's like I'm not in the clubs every night the way I used to be. Mm-hmm. I'm not at the award shows. I'm not at all the events. I'm not at all the, you know, the BET weekends or the Super Bowl weekends or whatever else. I really move more strategically in terms of what I do. So. Mm-hmm. You never really know who has a problem with you, and the person who probably has the biggest problem with you is not the one that's going to be talking about it.
Right.
So you always want to be prepared for the bullshit that comes with it.
Right. How do you feel about people look at your platform or label you as a police or officer? Mm-hmm. How do that? Just go off your shoulder or do it fuck with you a little bit? How what you think about it? Just part of the business?
I mean, it just is what it is. I mean, at the end of the day, when I came in to doing interviews and getting into this field, I looked at what real journalism is like. Mm-hmm. You know, like 60 Minutes and 2020 and the real hardcore, you know, the New York Times and the type of things that they do when they interview people and they break stories. Mm-hmm. And then I looked at hip hop journalism, and it was, hip hop journalism was just soft. Mm-hmm. Nobody wanted to ask the tough questions. Everyone just wanted to be a fan, and they wanted to be friends with the people they're interviewing, and it was actually just promo. I wouldn't even consider it journalism. It was just promo, essentially, for those people that are, you know, to help them sell, you know, help the artists sell their albums. Mm-hmm. And I just thought, a lot of these interviews are just boring, and they're just lame. Mm-hmm. So when I came in, I said, yo, I'm going to take more of the traditional approach of asking the tough questions and doing the research and everything. And hip hop wasn't used to that. Mm-hmm. So people start calling me the police or the feds and whatever else. Mm-hmm. And that's cool. You know, at the end of the day, I'm not the police, I'm not the feds. Right. You know, I don't work with the police. So if people want to say that, it's cool, it's whatever. Mm-hmm. You know, people call academics the police too. People call Sean Cotton the police. It just is what it is.
Right.
But most times I actually do my best to protect the person that I'm interviewing. Mm-hmm. You know, we know if there's an open case that we're not going to talk about it. Mm-hmm. We know if there's a murder that's unsolved, we're not going to talk about it. Mm-hmm. Now, if they went and, you know, if it's a Sammy the Bull who admitted to 19 murders, then I'm going to ask him about all the murders.
But
he's already admitted to it, and he already has immunity. Right. To everything, so we can't talk about it.
That's why informers, they get the best interview because they get to talk about everything.
They can talk about everything.
They heart desire to talk about.
That's right.
Right?
Yeah, they've done their deals, they've done their time, and they can talk about everything.
Right, and I'm sure you get a lot of calls, a lot of emails, people banging on your door to sit on your platform. What are some of the things that someone call you they want to talk about that you be like, I'm not going to touch that.
I don't give pedophiles a platform. Mm-hmm. I remember there was this one artist who's still in prison named South Park Mexican, who was in prison for impregnating like a 13-year-old. They wanted, you know, a lot of people asked me to interview him. I interviewed you know, there's a guy named Baby Bash, who was like a big artist who was sort of under his label. Mm-hmm. And we talked, you know, I talked to him about the situation on camera. And, you know, it was a bit of a gray area because the South Park Mexican dude went into a strip club, met a girl, took her home, slept with her. She got pregnant. She ended up being 13. Mm. But he's at a strip club where everyone's supposed to be 18. So you understand, you know, I understand there's a gray area associated with that, but I also feel like, you know, when you're with a 13-year-old.
Right, yeah.
You see what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, you kind of know. Mm-hmm. So that to me is one of the lines that I do, where it's like, if you're a pedophile, you're convicted pedophile, I don't want you on my platform.
What's your perspective on R. Kelly situation?
I think he's a pedophile. Right, but I've always thought he was a pedophile. Right. When that tape came out and it was circulating, and everyone got to see what that tape was, it was clear that, number one, that's R. Kelly, and number two, that looks like an underage girl.
It looked like an underage girl, right?
And it went to court, and he beat the case because the girl took the stand and said it wasn't her. But the girl just also filed for bankruptcy when he went to prison. So, you know, it is what it is. But yeah, I think R. Kelly is a pedophile. I mean, he got Aaliyah pregnant. That came out in his new trial.
Right.
When she was like 15.
Right.
And I think he's a fucked up individual. Right. I think he is where he's supposed to be right now.
Right.
Doing 30 years in prison and away from young kids.
Out the park, niggas know me. Curb on, little homie. All days. Yeah. Been a road.
Thank you for watching Changing Jewels on Kirkbone TV. If you like the jewels that we are dropping, subscribe, hit the notification, and share with some friends. And I see you on the next episode of Changing Jewels, Kirkbone TV.